Hey guys, welcome to 6 Feet 2 Inches vlog. So we are continuing with our motivation theories lecture, and this is lecture number 3. And since the chapter is very lengthy and there are theories of motivation, so I have like covered it into parts. So if you haven't seen previous two lectures, then please go through the two lectures before watching this one. So let's begin. Okay, so we are going to study Henri Maris' theory of needs. So before beginning the theory, it's extremely important for you to know the difference between approaches of personality study. So first one is ideographic approach, which means that anyone who is implementing this ideographic approach will be emphasizing on the subjective and personal experience of an individual. For example, projective test, which we have, like the ink blot test or thematic apperception test. These are the examples of ideographic approach. Okay. And second is nomothetic approach, which means that numerical and statistical data is collected, and from its conclusion, the standardized test is formed. For example, MCMI. So, personology. This term is used to describe his study of human lives and individual differences in personality. There are 5 principles given by Maris. The first one is personality is rooted in the brain. That is, the individual cerebral physiology guides and governs aspect of the personality. So according to him, it is the physiology because of which we are behaving the way we do, and especially he has emphasized physiology of cerebral part. So in a comment box, I would want you to comment what the function of cerebrum is. And the second principle is it involves the idea of tension reduction. So we have also seen the tension reduction in other theories as well. For example, in the theory of Freud, he has also emphasized on tension reduction, but according to Maris, it does not mean that we only constantly strive to stay tension free, because it would be like, it's not like the way we are conditioned. We have also seen this in arousal theory. We do strive to maintain an optimal level of arousal. Similar is the thing with tension balance. So we need some kind of tension to function appropriately. So hence he also supports the idea, but he supports the idea of tension reduction partially, not completely. The third principle of personology is individual personality continues to develop over time and is constructed of all the events that occur during the course of that person's life. Therefore, the study of person's past is important. Here, Henri Maris is focusing on past as well as whatever is happening to the person continuously over a period of time. So this is a difference between Freud's theory, which emphasizes only on the past of a person. Okay. And the fourth principle is personality isn't static or fixed. We can say it from the third statement only. If it's continuously developing, then it's not static or fixed. And the fifth and last principle of personology is that he emphasized on the uniqueness of each person. As he saw it, any individual human being is like no other person, or like some other person and like every other person. Okay, so I am trying my best to explain these concepts because you might get confused with Freud's concepts, because he is the first one to give the concept of id, ego and superego. And Maris has also given this concept or used this in his theory. So I have compared it side by side only, so you won't get confused. So do go through the video again if you are getting confused. Okay. So Maris has divided the personology in 3 parts. The first one is id, second is ego, and third is superego. So let's talk about id. According to Freud, it contains primitive, immoral, and lustful impulses. It's like a child, according to Freud. And according to Murray, it contains socially acceptable impulses like empathy and love. He was impressed by Jung's shadow archetype, which has good impulses as well as bad ones. The strength of each impulse vary among individuals. Okay, so he is differed from how Freud see it as. Freud see it as something bad, but according to Murray, it was something which is good, like socially acceptable impulses. And according to the Freud, it is like primitive or amoral impulses. This is the first difference of it. Second, we are going to learn about superego concept. So let's see the difference between Freud's and Murray's concept of superego. According to Freud, it develops as a result of interaction between child and parent, and superego acts as the parental voice. So at the age of 5, the superego of child is like completely developed. But according to Murray, the internalization of the culture's values and norms by which we come to evaluate and judge our behavior and that of others, it is called superego. And he suggested that superego does not develop at age 5, according to Freud. So he is differing at this point. It's completely different. According to Murray, the superego continues to develop throughout the lifespan. According to Freud, the superego is in constant conflict with it. If ego acts opposite to the demands of superego and does not meet its standard, for example, if your superego, which is developed by interacting with your parents, which says that stealing and lying is not good, and if your ego, like if you behave in the opposite way, that is if you steal someone's thing, then you will feel emotions like guilty or the feelings of inferiority, okay? But according to Murray, he has completely refused this concept of conflict with id, because according to Murray's theory, the id contains both the good as well as bad impulses. Remember this point, that according to Freud, the id contains only the bad impulses, but according to Murray, the id contains the good and bad impulses. So here is also one concept you should remember, which is ego ideal. While the superego is developing, so is the ego ideal is developing along with it. Ego ideal represents what we can become at our best. That is our idealized self-image. For example, you psychology students watching this video might be aspiring to become a best psychologist of your field. So that's your idealized self-image. But it is not what we can become if we do not meet superego standard. Okay, so if we do not meet superego standard, then the answer is guilt. It's not idealized self-image. Okay, now we are going to talk about ego. So it is a rational governor of personality. He opposed Freud's contention that ego is the slave of id, superego and reality. Please highlight this in your notes, that according to Freud, that ego is the slave of id, superego and reality. But according to Henry, ego organizes our behavior coming from the id impulses, whether it be good or bad. It suppresses unacceptable impulses and express acceptable impulses. There should be the balance between this ego, the way it is governing our id, because if the ego is constantly supporting the id, then it can lead the personality towards doing more crime, okay, if it's not under control. Hence, the balance is necessary for a personality to function properly in the society. Okay, so the theory of Henry Murray is organized in terms of motives, press, and needs. So motives, you mean like the motive behind the behavior, like what are you intending to achieve by acting that way? That is your motive. And press means the environmental situation you are in, which is invoking the behavior in you. It could be like external environmental situation or your internal process, such as hunger. And needs means what you really need, or you know what you want. Like needs, there is a definition of need given by Henry Murray, which you should memorize. I would say, please, I'm repeating, memorize it the way it is, because I have a personal experience of interview in CIP Ranchi. When they ask you any definition, or in any psychology examination, when we are asked definitions, we have to give the definition the way it is given by the psychologist. We do not have to add extra words, nor we have to remove any words given in the definition. So do go through the definition. I'm not saying the rant or cram up the definition. You don't have to mug up the definition. You have to understand what it means and then try to memorize it, okay? So definition of need according to Murray is potentiality or readiness to respond in a certain way under certain given circumstances or situations, you can say. But no, you don't have to use the word again, because I said that we can't change the words, because they expect us to give the definition the way it is given by the psychologist. So when need is activated, it is due to either internal process such as hunger, or external process such as like fight with your colleague or something. So needs are divided as following. There is first primary needs, which is also called as viscerogenic needs, which means biological needs such as hunger, sleep, your sexual needs. All these needs are primary needs. Then secondary needs are called psychogenic needs, which are evolved from the primary needs. Example, achievement need. So Murray has divided his psychogenic needs into 5 parts. The first one is ambition needs. Second is materialistic needs. Third is power needs. And fourth is status defense needs. Fifth is affection needs. Okay, so what is ambition needs? Ambition needs are related to the need for achievement and recognition. And materialistic needs center or emphasize on acquisition, construction, order, and retention. This needs often involve obtaining items such as buying material objects that we desire. And power needs tend to center or emphasize on our own independence or autonomy, as well as our need to control others. And affection needs are centered or emphasize on our desire to love and to be loved. You know, the need of seeking out the company of other people, that's need that comes under affection needs. And information needs, it emphasizes on gaining knowledge and sharing the knowledge you gain with others. So here is the complete lead psychogenic needs list given by Henry Murray in his book called Explorations in Personality, which was published in 1938, and he has divided the psychogenic needs into 5 groups, as I had explained in the previous slide. So under each needs, the sub needs are given. For example, under ambition needs, achievement need, exhibition need, recognition need is given, and also the definition is given. So I'm not going to read this out to you, because I want you to pause the video and read this and note it in your notebook or notes, because it's important to like know all the needs, because the thematic apperception test which we conduct on our clients, so when we are going to score the testing, so we will be, it's important for us to know the needs, the total needs which has been given. So hence, I request you to pause the video and go through the needs and note it down. Here the power needs are also explained. You can pause the video and note it down. So if there is any need which you are unable to understand, you can drop a comment or message me personally and I will explain it to you with example. Since the needs are very lengthy, around 26 needs, so it would be like the lecture would go around like more 30 minutes or so if I start explaining each needs. Hence, you read the definition which will help you to understand the needs, but still, in case if you don't understand, you can let me know the need name and I will explain it to you. Here the status, defense needs and affection needs are also given, and you can again pause the video, write it down in your notebook and read the definitions of each need. Now the information is, there is just two in it. You can just note it down, read it, and it's easy to remember because it's just two. First is cognizance, that is to seek knowledge and ask questions about things in order to understand or gain more knowledge. And second is exposition, which means to provide information or educate others. So I hope you have noted down all the needs and memorized it. Try to memorize as much as you can, because it's possible and quite possible to ask like specific needs and its definition. I mean, they won't just give the need name in the MCQs. They will first give the definition, then they will give you the options and ask you to choose the correct option, which is like the answer of the definition given in the question. So I'm not covering those need MCQs right now. I will be covering it in the final MCQ video, which I will be making once we complete the motivation chapter. So you will get enough time to go through all the needs and previous lectures from emotion theories and emotions, as well as motivation lectures. So here is the concept check video, and I hope you have really noted down all the needs. It's just good for you. Plus, in return, I can assure you that they won't ask you like complete needs in a way. But in interview, according to my personal experience, they can ask you to name all the needs. So it's better you memorize the needs, at least the needs under subtypes. Try to memorize as much as you can. So the concept check MCQs. The first one is, thematic apperception test is based on theory given by, options are A. Freud, B. Maslow, C. H. Murray, D. Rogers. Take your time, pause the video, try to answer and then go to the next slide. Okay, so the correct answer is C. H. Murray. I hope you got it right, because it was extremely easy. Okay, so thanks for watching. Do subscribe and share the video with your friends and stay tuned for more upcoming conceptual videos related to NET, JRF, SET Psychology and for MCQs, which will be uploaded once a week based on all the lectures which I will be sharing from Monday to Saturday. So do go through the videos. Thank you.